And there are many Christians, and they've come to the cross, they've understood the death of Jesus, they've come to the cross and said, Lord, please forgive me. But they've not come to the burial and said, I am buried with Christ. This will never play a role in my life again. This is not going to rise up and haunt me.
On today's program, Charles Price challenges us to consider baptism as a vital part of the Christian experience. Find out what baptism symbolizes. This week, Buried with Christ.
If you've got a Bible this morning, I'm going to read to you from the book of Romans in chapter 6. I'm going to read just two verses to you from chapter 6. Romans chapter 6, verse 3 and 4. And this, of course, is just a brief extract from something that Paul is teaching that is central to the Christian gospel. Verse 3 says, don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were, therefore, buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. That's as far as I'm going to read. I'm going to talk to you this morning about the burial of Jesus. Not about his death, not about his resurrection, but about the intervening part when he was buried. And as Paul says here, we were buried with him through baptism into death. Now, I confess I've never preached on the burial of Jesus before. I don't think I've ever heard a sermon on the burial of Jesus. But it is clearly important in the New Testament. And last week, we began to look at the teaching of this chapter, Romans 6, about baptism, water baptism, which we defined as an outward physical act that portrays an inward spiritual truth. We're familiar with the outward physical act. When somebody is baptized in the way that we do it here, many churches do it, they go down into water. They're immersed under the water, and they're brought back up, soaking wet. But the picture is of dying with Christ, buried with him, and risen with him. That is the outward physical act, but it is designed to portray an inward spiritual reality. And the inward spiritual reality is that when Jesus Christ died, as we explained last week, he didn't just die for us, but we died in him. We are united with him. What is true of Christ is imputed to be true of us. I, Charles Price, was crucified with Christ legally, if I may put it this way, before God. I have died in the person of a substitute. I have been buried with him in order to be raised again to walk in newness of life. The outward physical act is important. Baptism is important. And I want at the end of this short series to challenge you, if you've never been baptized in water, to do so out of obedience and because of the significance and importance of what it is portraying. But if we talk, there are three parts to this. We talked about the first part last week, dying with Christ. The grounds on which we are declared justified, because we have been crucified with Christ. All that I deserve has been paid in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm crucified with him, but then I am buried with him. And this is an aspect that perhaps we don't think very much about, but it seems clear as I have looked into Scripture to think about this, that it is important because it is reiterated so many times. Here in verse 4, we were therefore buried with him through baptism into death. In Colossians chapter 2 and verse 12, Paul says there that the grounds for our liberation from the demands of the law is that we have been buried with him in baptism. In 1 Corinthians 15 and verse 3, Paul gives the essential facts of the gospel, and they include this, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures. Now, Paul, we might think, could have written that and omitted the bit about him being buried. He could have said that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures and that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures. And we would probably think there was nothing missing in that statement, but there would have been something missing. And what would be missing was that he was buried. And clearly the burial of Jesus is an important element in the gospel. And I want to talk about this morning. And I trust in so doing that there may be many here who may find a new freedom and liberation in understanding the significance of this. I want to talk about two things. I want to talk, first of all, about the burial of Jesus himself, the historical event, the burial of Jesus. And then I want to talk about what Paul addresses here in Romans 6, our burial with Jesus. Baptism is the outward physical act that portrays this as an inward spiritual truth. Let me talk first then about the burial of Jesus himself. And you may be aware of this, that although Jesus Christ was buried in a tomb, he ought not to have been buried because he died, according to Roman law, as a criminal. And as a criminal, his body was the possession of the Roman authorities. And the normal practice was that the bodies of those who have been crucified were incinerated by being thrown onto a fire that burned continuously in the valley of Gehenna, which is a very little but very sharp valley outside the southern wall of the city of Jerusalem. It was really the rubbish dump of Jerusalem. All the garbage was thrown down into that little gully, and there was a fire at the bottom which continually burned. And so the garbage was being burned all the time, and everybody from Jerusalem would bring their garbage and dump it there, and the carcasses of animals that died were thrown onto this fire in the valley of Gehenna, and the bodies of criminals who had been executed were thrown onto this fire. The two thieves that were crucified either side of Jesus would have been taken and dumped there. That was the normal process, and the family had no rights of access to that body. They were now the possession of the Roman authorities, and they buried them as they saw fit. But Jesus' body was not placed there. And I want to explain why. And then I want to explain the significance of why. We know that Jesus was crucified because early on the morning of his crucifixion, the highest Jewish authority that existed, the Sanhedrin Council, which consists of 71 members presided over by the high priest, met together and they passed a resolution to recommend to the Roman governor, Pontius Pilate, that Jesus should be crucified. They trumped up charges against him. They had charges of terrorism. He's going to destroy the temple in Jerusalem because he told them, you destroy this temple in 3 days, I'll rebuild it, talking, of course, about his own body. They accused him of blasphemy because he claimed to be the Son of God. And they had their list of charges that in Jewish law warranted his execution, but they couldn't authorize it themselves. They had to have come to the Roman governor, Pontius Pilate, with the recommendation that Jesus be crucified. Pilate listened to his case that same morning. He wanted to get him off his hands. And it just so happened that Herod, who was the ruler in Galilee, was in Jerusalem at the time. Jesus came from Galilee, so he sent him across to Herod for Herod to interview. Herod sent him back to Pilate. Pilate went out to the crowd and said, what shall I do with this man? And they began to chant, crucify him, crucify him, crucify him. So he handed him over to be whipped by the soldiers. They took him out to the hill called Golgotha, and they put him on the cross at 9 o'clock in the morning. Things had moved very quickly. What time the Sanhedrin Council had met, we don't know. But they met very early to make this recommendation. But the recommendation of the Sanhedrin Council was not unanimous. There were 71 members on the council, and the vote, if you read the New Testament very carefully, you'll see the vote was 69 for and 2 against the recommendation that he should be crucified. And the two against were, first of all, a man called Joseph of Arimathea. It tells us in Luke 23, verse 50, there was a man named Joseph, a member of the council, and actually Mark chapter 15 describes him as a prominent member of the council. So he was influential in the council. And it says that Joseph, a member of the council, a good and upright man, had not consented to their decision and action. So that's one vote against. Joseph Arimathea had not consented with the others. The other vote was a man called Nicodemus. He was introduced to us earlier in John chapter 3, verse 1, as a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a member of the Jewish ruling council. And these two men were friends of Jesus, and both of them voted against the recommendation. Now, here's the significance. These two men were the only friends of Jesus who knew that Jesus was going to die that day, unless Pilate had vetoed the recommendation. Jesus' own disciples did not know he was going to die. He had told them, they didn't believe it. And so by the time he was hung on the cross at 9 o'clock, these two men, Joseph Arimathea, Nicodemus, worked to give him a proper burial. It says in John 19 that Joseph was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly because he feared the Jews. But there comes a moment when you throw caution to the wind and you stand up to be counted. And for Joseph Arimathea, this was the moment. And he and Nicodemus planned a burial for Jesus, but of course the body belonged to the Roman authorities. So at the time that Jesus died, or actually it was just before Jesus died, tells us John 19:38, Joseph of Arimathea asked Pilate for the body of Jesus. It was Pilate's prerogative. And so he asked Pilate for the body of Jesus. And then it says, with Pilate's permission, he came and took the body away. And later, it says he was accompanied by Nicodemus, the man who had earlier visited Jesus at night. And taking Jesus' body, the two of them wrapped it with spices in strips of linen, which was in accordance with Jewish burial customs. And at the place where Jesus was crucified, there was a garden. In the garden, a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid. And because there was a Jewish day of preparation, and since the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there. Now, this is interesting. They took the body of Jesus, placed him in a tomb in which no one had ever laid, that was close to the place where he had been crucified. If you go to Jerusalem today, there are two sites that claim to possibly be the tomb of Jesus. Nobody can know for sure. One is an ancient site over which is built the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. And that church was built in the 4th century under Constantine's instruction in 326 AD, when Constantine had become converted in 313 AD, issued his Edict of Milan, which allowed Christianity to legally exist in the Roman Empire, which it hadn't been allowed to do up until then. And he took an interest in the sites related to Jesus' life, death, and resurrection, and he authorized a church to be built over this site that was thought could be the tomb of Jesus. If you go to Israel, to Jerusalem today, you would probably visit the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. It is jointly run by the Greek Orthodox Church and by the Armenian Apostolic Church and the Roman Catholic Church. And so if you go there today, it's full of the practices of these churches related to icons and relics and all this kind of thing. But it's there and has been operating there for many centuries. The other site that stakes a claim to possibly being the tomb of Jesus is known as the Garden Tomb, and it was only identified in the 19th century, so it's relatively recent, identified by a man called General Gordon. When he came to Jerusalem, he saw a rock face. It's about 50 meters sheer rock with a couple of caves, one here, a sort of bridge between them, and another cave at the bottom. And he looked at that and said, that looks just like a skull. And if you go and look at it today, you'll see exactly why he thought that. On top is a sort of green area. Golgotha, where Jesus was crucified, was known as the place of the skull. Some have said it's because people were put to death there and there were bones and skulls and all kinds of things. It's called the place of the skull, but maybe not. Maybe it's because the shape of the rock on which it was the shape of a skull. So General Gordon, going back to his New Testament, said, in that case, if this is Golgotha, near Golgotha was a tomb. And around the corner, there were a couple of graves hewn into the rock. One of them has an opening, behind it a cave with a shelf in it, and in front is a gully where a stone would have been rolled along to seal the tomb. And there are many, many reasons for recognizing this could well be the site. But the interesting thing about the garden tomb is when you go inside, it is shaped with a little platform on which would be laying the body. And if you look carefully, at one end, there's been another about 2 inches chiseled in, additional 2 inches to the original size of it, indicating that perhaps the body that was buried here was not the original body that was intended, but a body that was about 2 inches taller. And Jesus was buried in a tomb that had been made for somebody else. In fact, made for Joseph of Arimathea himself in his own tomb. That is fascinating. But why am I telling you this? Is it because it is simply a fluke of history that Jesus happened to have two friends on the Sanhedrin Council who had the advance notice he was going to be crucified? Let's get ready to bury him properly. Let's get all the myrrh and spices and linen together that we can give him a proper burial. No, it is more significant than that. Because the scriptures had prophesied in advance that he would be buried, and the prophecies about his burial are very specific. Let me read you what Isaiah 53 and verse 9 says. Isaiah 53, many of you know, is the classic prophecy about the crucifixion of Christ. Describes in detail the effects of crucifixion. And then it says this, he was assigned a grave with the wicked, that's in verse 9 of Isaiah 53, and with the rich man in his death. What does that mean? One commentator suggests a good alternative way to translate this would be to say, his grave was appointed with the wicked, but with the rich man was his tomb. That makes it a very remarkable prophecy about Christ. His grave was appointed with the wicked. He died as a criminal outside the city walls, crucified by the Roman authorities, destined in normal circumstances for the incineration of his body that happened to all the Roman criminals who were put to death. But as this prophecy had said over 700 years before, his grave was appointed with the wicked, but with the rich man was his tomb. And Matthew 27, verse 57, introducing Joseph of Arimathea, says, as evening approached, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph. And going to Pilate, he asked for Jesus' body. Here's a rich man taking the body of Jesus, who had died with the wicked, and burying him in a rich man's tomb. And more than 700 years before Christ was ever born, Isaiah, writing prophetically, says his grave was appointed with the wicked, but with the rich man was his tomb. And exactly, precisely as Isaiah had written, the story unfolds. I have said before, and I'll say it again, we have a better reason for believing the facts about Jesus than simply that the Bible tells us that they happened. And the better reason for believing is that the Bible told us that they would happen long before they did, and in every instance was exactly precise. That's a better reason for believing. If you pick up today's newspaper and read yesterday's news, you're not impressed, you expect to do that. If you pick up today's newspaper and read next week's news, and next week it happens exactly as was written this week, you probably want to know who the editor is. And if he wrote next month's news this week and it happened next month exactly, and next year's, how about 750 years in advance? Exactly. You probably would want to know the editor, wouldn't you? That means that the burial of Jesus was not just an incidental bit of detail, but in the mind and heart of God was predetermined with a purpose. Now, what is that purpose? So much so that as Paul says in Romans 6, in explaining the meaning of baptism, not only have we died with Christ, crucified with Christ, but we have been buried. We are therefore buried with him through baptism into death. So what is the meaning of our burial with Jesus? Well, let me suggest this to you. There is a finality about burial. When somebody dies, the period between their death and their burial is often a very difficult time. People talk a lot about the person who has just died, of course. And very often they speak in the present tense about that person. But the moment the funeral takes place, nobody talks in the present tense. It's all past tense now. How old was she? Where did she live? We have an expression in our English language when we say of something, maybe an idea or a plan that's finished, we say, hey, that is dead and buried. What we mean by buried is it's gone. It's done with. So it is with us that the burial of Christ says he not only took my sin on himself on the cross, he not only died my death, as we talked about last week, so that we stand before God, if I may use this term and hope you understand it, legally we are justified. Justice has been satisfied fully and completely. Not only have we died in Christ, but the sin that was the cause of that death has been buried with him. It is over. It is gone. And the symbolism of that aspect of baptism is not only have I died with Christ, but buried with him. You know, some of us who are Christians have recognized that we have died with Christ. We understand the death of Jesus as our substitute. And we understand our union with him, that I died in Christ as far as God is concerned. But we've never understood that we've been buried with him. Buried. In other words, our sin, our guilt, our past is buried. And the reason why I say many of us don't grasp this is because we go on interacting with our sin. We go on interacting with our guilt. We go on interacting with our past. We come back and confess the same sins again and again sometimes, because we don't really know that they've gone. What does God do with our sin? There are a number of graphic pictures that he gives to us, and I've pulled out six I'm going to give to you, that in different ways are saying the same thing about the finality of the sin that has been placed on Christ. That it's gone, it's dealt with, it's buried. but using different pictures and imagery. In Micah chapter 7, here's the first one, verse 18 and 19. It says, "Who is a God like you who pardons sin and forgives the transgression of the remnant of his inheritance? You will again have compassion on us. You will tread our sins underfoot," listen, "and hurl all our iniquities into the depths of the sea." The idea of that is that hurling our iniquities into the depths of the sea is that it is beyond recovery. You've taken our sins and you've dumped them in the sea and they've sunk and they've gone. Corrie ten Boom used to say that when God threw our sins into the depths of the sea, he put up a sign that says, "No fishing." But a lot of us do go fishing there. Some of you go fishing there. One of the biggest holes the devil has on many people is that they go fishing into the area that God has thrown into the depths of the sea and removed them from us. And sometimes we're so conscientious, we're so embarrassed about the fact that we don't deserve this. We don't allow ourselves to understand and enjoy the liberty and freedom, although we don't deserve it. Our sin has been buried with Christ. Here's another verse, Psalm 103, verse 12. David says, "As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us." Now notice, he doesn't say, "As far as the north is from the south," but "as far as the east is from the west." You see, the north is a fixed point. The south is a fixed point. If you go north, you'll cross the North Pole and begin to go south. Earlier this year, I flew from Toronto to Hong Kong, and we took off, it's a non-stop flight, took off from about 10 hours from Toronto, and we flew due north, right up over the Arctic Circle. And having flown north, and we had a little map you could follow the journey on, having flown north over the Arctic Circle, without changing direction, we began to go south and cut across Siberia and then down over China and eventually into Hong Kong. If you go north, you start to go south. It's a fixed point. But if you go east, you can go right around the world and never begin to go west. If you go west, you can go right around the world and never begin to go east. And says David, "As far as the east is from the west." In other words, this is infinity. These are irreconcilable points. He has taken your sin. As far as the east is that way, as far as the west is that way, he's removed them from you. Let me give you the third picture. It's in Isaiah 38 and verse 17, where it says, "You put all my sins behind your back." Now listen, if God is omnipresent, that means he's in all places at all times as he is, where is there such a place that can be described as being behind his back? And the answer is, I don't know, because nothing's behind his back except our sin. It's so far out, it's in a place that doesn't even exist. He's thrown it behind his back. Here's another one, the fourth one, Isaiah 43, verse 25. "I, even I, am he who blots out your transgressions for my own sake and remembers your sins no more." Now that phrase or similar phrase to it is used several times in the Bible. He remembers our sins no more. This is a unique ability that God has. Not that he's forgetful, but he never recalls it. He will never use it as evidence against you. God isn't naive about it, of course, but he never recalls. He never brings back. He remembers it no more. I wish we believed that. I think some of us are like two brothers I heard about. And these two brothers had been fighting all day. And at the end of the day, the mother came to the elder of the two boys and said, "Listen, you've been fighting your brother all day long today. You need to make it up with him and say you're sorry before you go to bed." He said, "I'm not going to make it up. I'm going to say I'm sorry. He started it. It's his fault." So his mother tried to appeal to his sentiment a little bit. And she said, "Just suppose your brother died during the night. Wouldn't you be sorry in the morning if you hadn't forgiven him?" This boy thought for a moment, and then he said, all right, I'll forgive him. But if he's alive in the morning, You know, I think some of us have that feeling, don't we? God, please forgive me. And he does, but I'm scared stiff about the morning. Well, Romans 8, verse 1 says, Romans 8, verse 1, the fifth of these verses I'm giving to you, it says, there is now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. No condemnation. God has nothing against you, in other words. And yet, I know many Christians who do feel condemned, but I'll tell you this, it is not the voice of the Holy Spirit that's speaking to you, it's the voice of Satan. One of Satan's tasks, Revelation chapter 12, verse 10, tells us, is that he is the accuser of our brothers. He accuses them before our God day and night. And brothers there includes sisters. It's an inclusive usage there. One of Satan's ministries, if you like, is to accuse you. It's not difficult. There's all kinds of junk he can haul up and remind you of. But there's a picture in the book of Zechariah of a man called Joshua who's standing before God, and he's standing before God dressed in filthy rags, and Satan is standing at his right side accusing him. And he's standing dressed in these filthy clothes. And he's accusing him to the Lord. And then it says, the Lord rebuke you, Satan. And the Lord said to an angel who was standing before him, take off his filthy clothes and put on him a clean clothes with a clean turban. And then he said to this man, Joshua, see, I have taken away your sin and I have put rich garments on you. But he's standing like many Christians stand. Satan's at their side, accusing. And the result is they're dressed in filthy rags. They feel dirty. They act as though they're dirty. They're embarrassed about their dirt. And God says, rebuke Satan. Satan, get out of here. Cover him in clean clothes. And you and I are not dressed in the dirt of our own past, we are dressed in the righteousness of Jesus Christ. There is no condemnation. When the Holy Spirit speaks about your sin, he convicts. When the devil speaks, he condemns. There's a big difference. With conviction, he also points to us the way out. He doesn't convict us of sin in order to humiliate us and embarrass us and condemn us. He convicts us of sin in order to liberate us. He points to the cross of Christ. But when the devil condemns, it's like a wet blanket that sits on you. You can't move. And the last verse I'm going to give you is in 1 John 4 and verse 17, where it says, in this way, love is made complete among us so that we will have confidence on the day of judgment. Because in this world, we are like him. That's an amazing verse. This is the extent to which God's love is complete among us. And on the day of judgment, we will have confidence. Why? Because in this world, we are like him. Why are we like him? Because there was a day when he was like me, when he was made sin for me. And when he died, I died in him. He was my substitute. I died in him. He was buried. We were therefore buried with him, as Romans 6 says. But I've risen now to walk in newness of life. That newness of life is now the life of Jesus Christ within us. And we're now clothed with his righteousness. We have a righteousness that is not our own. Remember, some time ago, I was going to preach and I was very aware of some sin in my life. And I thought to myself, how in the world is God going to use me in this situation? Because I know what I'm like. How is God going to take what I am going to say and use it in people's lives? And God spoke to me. It wasn't any words. It was a sudden realization that came into my heart, and I have no doubt it came from God. This has nothing at all to do with your righteousness. If it did, all your righteousness would be like filthy rags. That's what the book of Isaiah says about our righteousness. This has nothing to do with how good you are. This is my righteousness that you're going to stand in and speak from. And we need to know that. That's why Paul, here in Romans 6, don't you know that you're baptized into his death, and we were therefore buried with him through baptism into death? Don't you know this? This is objective truth. This is not a subjective feeling. It's as objectively true that we have died with Christ and been buried with him as it is that Christ died for us and was buried for us, because we've been united to Christ in our standing before God. Therefore, it has nothing to do with how you feel. We don't believe that Jesus Christ was crucified and buried because we feel it. And we don't believe that I have been crucified with him and buried with him because I feel it. It is a fact, an accomplished fact. And there are many Christians, and they've come to the cross, they've understood the death of Jesus, they've come to the cross and said, Lord, please forgive me. But they've not come to the burial and said, I am buried with Christ. This will never play a role in my life again. This is not going to rise up and haunt me. This is not going to appeal to my conscientiousness and say, hey, you shouldn't feel good about anything anymore because you've messed up in such a bad way. It is gone, but we don't believe it. We don't believe it. And the worst sinner I know is me. And I know all the thousands of reasons why I am totally disqualified from knowing God. But every one of those reasons was attached to Jesus Christ on his cross, and it was buried with him. And undeserving as I am, and undeserving as you are, we accept the incredible work of Jesus Christ on our behalf. I not just confess my sin to know I am forgiven, but I go with him into the burial, into the grave, and I leave it there. And you know, many of us don't make progress in the Christian life because we don't get this far. You know, a lot of Christians come to the cross. That's the substance of their Christian life. Okay, my sins are forgiven. And then the understanding is basically, okay, now I'm going to go to heaven when I die, so hang around, get sprinkled with disinfectant once in a while to keep you clean, but then eventually you're going to get washed up there on the shores of heaven. No, we are forgiven because we are united with Christ in his death. God's justice is addressed and satisfied. That sin is buried. Therefore, undeserving as we are, it's past, it's gone. That lady who came to me in her 40s 20 years ago, I committed a sin. I've confessed it to God 1,000 times. A day doesn't pass by that I don't think about that particular thing. I said to her, you know, it's not God that's speaking to you every day about that thing. It's the devil. He's got a foothold in your life because this is a nice, juicy sin that he's going to squeeze the life out of you with. And in your conscientiousness, you know you deserve it, and so you accept it. But although you do deserve it, Christ took it from you. Will you let him have it? Will you let him not only carry it in his own body on the cross, will you let it go into the tomb and seal the tomb? It's gone. What purpose? phew, I'm off the hook. No. As we're going to pick up next week. Don't you know? All of us were baptized into Christ Jesus, were baptized into his death. We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death. Listen to this. In order that, this is the purpose, just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. Not the old life, but it's going to heaven instead of hell, but a new life. It's not changing just your destination. It's changing the very composition of your life. This new life, as we'll see next week, is the very life of Jesus himself. I've been crucified with Christ, yet I live, says Paul, but it's not I. Christ lives in me. That's the new life. We should talk about next week. But I have no doubt there are folks here this morning, and you've understood that the cross of Christ, the death of Jesus, is the grounds by which your sin may be forgiven because he satisfied the justice of God. But you've never understood you were buried with him. And the tomb was closed and sealed. And everybody went home. It's over. And the foothold that the devil has in many of our lives, and we're told not to give the devil a foothold, is this very thing, the foothold of our sin by which he comes to condemn and hold us back from enjoying the new life is designed to be lived in us and through us. Baptism in water is the outward physical act that portrays that, but I'm coming to believe, because of the importance of water baptism in Scripture, that sometimes it's that act of baptism that demonstrates this not just to ourselves and to other people around us, as Ephesians chapter 3 says, that through the church, the manifold wisdom of God is made known to the principalities and powers in the heavenly realms. In other words, through his people, this is one aspect, in demonstrating this, we're saying to all those principalities and powers which are described as evil, in hostile towards God, hostile towards us, that we demonstrate to them in this act of baptism that this person has been crucified with Christ, and are you watching, principalities and powers in heavenly realms? Buried. Over. There's a finality to this. But risen again to walk in newness of life. And some of you are stagnant in your Christian life because you've never been baptized. But the outward physical act is only valid as it portrays the inward spiritual truth. And that's why we need to know what it is to be crucified with Christ. Yes, he died and I died in him. He was buried, I was buried. And all the sin that brought about his death is buried with him. And the resurrection is not to the old life. That stays dead. But to a new life. And I'm speaking in particular to those who are probably Christians, or if you're not yet a Christian, this is part of the gospel. The gospel is essentially about being reconciled to God. These are the means by which a human being can be reconciled to God. But those of us who are Christians who have understood the cross, understood he died for me, and I can confess my sin to be forgiven, but we've never understood that we have the not only the right, but the obligation to see that as buried, and it's behind you, and leave it there. It's buried. I want you to renounce all your past sin, to renounce the devil's hold that he has on us because of our conscientiousness and the sensitivity of our hearts that says, I don't deserve this. The more sensitive you are, the bigger your struggle with this. But you've got to say, Lord, I don't deserve it. But it's not me that's on trial here. It's Christ who's on trial here. Did he take my sin to the grave? The answer is, he did. So why in the world are you still playing with it? Let it be buried. God will bring a fresh liberty. See, that clears the decks. That now I can begin to understand and enjoy what this new life is. That is the resurrection life. But if you're still bogged down in your sin, you'll never enjoy the resurrection life.
Watch this message again, go to our website, livingtruth.ca. You can also order DVDs and CDs, download transcripts, sign up for our monthly newsletter, check out the Living Truth Daily Devotional, sign up for podcasts, and read faith stories from other viewers. We love to hear from you, so send us your comments and testimonies. Living Truth is supported by viewers like you. Thank you for transforming lives through your financial participation. Tune in again next week for another message from Charles Price, Risen with Christ. Is baptism a man-made ritual or a God-given command? What does baptism symbolize?
Baptism by immersion gives graphic picture of what it means to, first of all, die with Christ, the act of going down into the water, being buried with Christ, being put under the water, and the third movement, being risen with Christ, coming up out of the water.
In this three-part series, Charles Price explores the meaning of baptism and why it is important for all Christians. To order, call our toll-free number, +1-416-222-3341, extension 113, or log on to our secure website, livingtruth.ca, and order online. By mail, write to the address on your screen. This series is an excellent resource for you and your church. Philip is a keen amateur photographer. These pictures of his recent journey to Israel bring back the intense emotions he felt there.
You are in the middle of the Sea of Galilee on a boat, and you almost feel how the disciples would have felt when Jesus came that same water and we were there. It's an unbelievable feeling.
Philip's spiritual journey began when he was just a teen. It was during a time of struggle and poverty in war-torn Sri Lanka.
And I was in the middle of it, and I was 14 years old. My car was torched while I was inside the car. How I escaped that, I still have no idea.
Philip's life was spared. He was raised in a Christian home, so he dutifully thanked God for his protection.
I used to say, God, thank you for giving me a place to sleep. And thank you for giving me food. Bless everyone. Amen. And that was all my relationship.
In 2000, Philip moved to Canada in search of hope and a better life. He made a quick climb up the corporate ladder, but he knew something was missing.
And that's when I realized that, wow, I need to be saved, because until such time, I never thought you can have a relationship with Jesus. Like you can bring him to your day-to-day life.
Philip made the decision to make Jesus his personal savior, and he believed the difficulties in his life were over.
I have starved when I was a kid. You know, I've seen riots, lost life, bomb blasts, and all those things. But I thought eventually now it's everything is settled. I'm having a relationship with God. So I thought, end of story.
But for Philip, It was just the beginning. And before he knew it, everything he held dear was lost.
Including my job, my health. And I thought, okay, this is bad. I just became a Christian, so shouldn't I be blessed and I should have all these things and I should be fine. So why is this happening to me? You know, in my language, there is a saying, what is worse than death is being forgotten. God was silent, and silence was killing me.
He found hope for his weary soul when Living Truth decided to host a tour to the Holy Land.
It didn't even take 2 minutes for me to decide. I said, brilliant, I'm going. Photography is my passion. Israel is a historical place. I thought that'll be a cool place to go. And I can take tons of pictures there.
Fascinated by the history of the Holy Land, Philip busied himself with being a good tourist.
Then Moses raised his arm and struck the rock.
I was not the guy who was turning the Bible and listening to Charles Price or nodding my head, that's a good point. No, I was the guy who was with the camera trying to, you know, shoot, and I said, oh, that's a good point. Yeah, that's nice. Okay, let's see what else. And I was so interested in taking people's expressions.
When the Holy Land tour reached its stop at the River Jordan, Hilary Price began to preach a message on John the Baptist. For the first time on the tour, Philip put down his camera and paused to listen.
And between the end of the Old Testament and the beginning of the New Testament, there is 400 years of silence, where humans and God are no longer on speaking terms with each other.
So she said, are you waiting for something in your life? Do you think God has abandoned you? So that's the time I stopped my camera and said, yeah, of course, yes. Do you think God is silent? God is not doing anything to you?
And you might be in a place in your life at the moment where you're standing in the middle of God's preparation for something and you don't know it. Just wait.
That point went like zoom into my heart.
Hilary went on to describe God as the conductor of an orchestra who, even in the silence between notes, still has command of the beat.
So then Hilary said, in your life, you may not hear anything. There is no music. There's nothing happening. You must be thinking God is forgotten, but God is still doing this. And I thought, wow, God, thank you.
Philip had finally found the assurance that God had been listening all along.
A lot of things happened to me in my life. My life, remember I told you it was dry like the desert? He changed, he made it into an oasis. But the point that I'm trying to make is, even if he has not blessed me the way he has blessed me now, right after my trip, even if he has taken another 10 years, I'm still fine because I know God is still doing this. So that's where I am now.
Never harm you, they are plans to prosper you, may I'm blessed to never harm you. And I will watch over you, as I will watch over you. And I will listen to you, as I will listen to you. When you whisper or cry out a prayer, oh, I promise, as I will be there. I hear you, says the Lord. Of your